The Game by Judy Gardner. Read by Jenny Seagrove.
Travelling west along the A406, not far from Staples Corner, there are three sets of traffic lights within a short distance of one another. And it was at the first of these that Millie Ellenbogen was accustomed to lean from the passenger window and say in a little deadly voice to the driver on her left,
"Please help me. I'm being kidnapped."
Her husband, Forbes, had no knowledge of Millie's pastime because his mind was always occupied by A, driving, and B, work. He was a sedate man with small eyes, set closely in the shelter of a large nose, and he and Millie were partners in a modest business that supplied hotels and restaurants with table linen. "Specialists in napery," was how Forbes described it, and even referred to himself as a naperist, until someone at a party somewhere thought he said naturist and asked whether he was allowed to keep his watch on. He worked hard, much harder than Millie, who only accompanied him on his business trips as a means of escaping from the tedium of bookkeeping and letter typing. But the A406, with its gasworks and garbage, its factories and fumes, was merely exchanging one sort of tedium for another. And so Millie invented the game as a harmless way of alleviating it. Reactions varied. Some drivers didn't hear, some heard and refused to believe the evidence of their ears, while others, to judge from their sudden loss of road sense, heard and believed and didn't know what to do. These, obviously, were the ones who really made the game worthwhile. But the game ended on the day that Millie accosted the pockmarked man in the old black Studebaker. Bored with Forbes and hotel table linen and the hot stench of the A406, she directed her tremulous appeal through the open window and was gratified to see his eyes widen in horrified disbelief.
"God almighty, Baggy Aggie," he cried above the roar of revving engines. "You're supposed to be in Pontefract."
"I've been kidnapped," Millie repeated with slightly less conviction and a little quieter.
"Who the hell's he?"
The man jerked his thumb at Forbes, who was stolidly preparing to engage first gear.
"I didn't catch his name," said Millie rapidly, "but I think he's one of the other lot."
The lights changed, and the traffic zoomed. Vastly amused, Millie sat back and contemplated the thundering rear of a petrol tanker. The game had never worked so well before. At the next halt, the man pulled the Studebaker in close and leaned urgently from his window, his eyes darting nervously at Forbes.
"Listen, Pat, they made a mess of Harry."
"Oh, dear."
17 stitches and a busted nose. They got him down at Lazy Maisie's."
Lazy Maisie, thought Millie delightedly, and Baggy Aggie. Poor man's completely mad.
As the third set of lights turned to red, he drew level again.
"Bag,"
he said feverishly.
"If the West Ham crowd know you're back, they'll go over you. They'll go over you, Bag, same as they went over Harry."
"But you won't talk."
It seemed a reasonable request. The man smiled.
"I only talk with this," he said,
and with a smooth, almost imperceptible movement, slid the muzzle of a small revolver over the edge of the Studebaker's window.
"I'll see you right, Bag," he said through clenched teeth. "Don't you worry. I'll see you right."
The lights turned green, and so did Millie. Suddenly, the game wasn't funny anymore.
"I feel a bit sick," Millie ventured as they headed for Ealing.
"Then why shut the window?" asked Forbes.
"I felt cold."
"Well, I can't stop here."
"No, I don't want to."
"Shall I turn off somewhere?"
"Yes, no. Oh, just keep going. I don't want a man in a black car to catch up with us."
"What's this, some sort of game?"
asked Forbes, increasing to 50 along a clear stretch of road.
"In a way,"
said Millie, and managed a wan smile. But they reached Richmond without incident and without further sight of the Studebaker, the only black vehicle they encountered being a hearse. Millie began to relax very slightly. The Queen's Hotel overlooked the river, and before getting out of the car, she asked Forbes if he could arrange to park somewhere out of sight. "Now look," began Forbes, heaving the case of napery samples from the back seat. Then his expression softened.
"If you're still feeling rotten, Pop in the bar and have a brandy. I'll join you later. He walked off towards the manager's office. With a final hasty glance round, Millie slipped from the car and sped like an arrow into the hotel. At midday, the place was still rather empty, and she settled herself in an inconspicuous corner from which she could see the door. She ordered a double brandy, and then on second thoughts ordered one for Forbes as well. Several men came into the bar, but none of them was the pockmarked driver of the Studebaker. When Forbes came in search of her, he was smiling and rubbing his hands. 5 dozen double damask table napkins, he began, then stopped when he saw the waiting brandy. Good Lord, did you order this for me? Millie nodded mournfully. He sat down beside her. In that case, cheers. Tell you what, why don't we have lunch here? We don't often treat ourselves, and life's only short, isn't it?
Yes, said Millie. It could end at any time.
He studied her solicitously.
Don't still feel ill, do you?
No, said Millie in a smothered voice. Just a bit on edge.
They went through to the dining room, and the pockmarked man wasn't in there either. It began to look as if they had given him the slip after all. Heartened, Millie chose avocado, followed by canard à l'orange, while Forbes ordered half a bottle of wine. And halfway through the meal, the urge to confess suddenly overwhelmed her.
Forbes,
she said, leaning across the table and looking deep into his eyes.
Sometimes I play a horrible sort of game with myself.
Oh?
The peas that Forbes had assembled carefully on his fork quivered inquiringly.
I pretend that I'm being kidnapped, and I ask strange men to rescue me going along in the car.
Why?
I don't know, Forbes.
It could lead you into trouble, he said at length.
He already has, Millie said, and told him about the man in the Studebaker.
A gun? Repeated Forbes. You dreamed it.
I swear I didn't, she said. He kept calling me Baggy Aggie and going on about someone called Harry.
Harry who?
I don't know, but he got a lot of stitches and a busted nose.
You dreamed it, Forbes repeated. And it's a sign that you need an outlet.
Oh?
I've often thought that travelling in Napery isn't enough for a creative person like you. You ought to go to evening classes or something.
He poured the last of the wine, and it came to Millie then that she loved Forbes very much indeed.
I've been a fool.
No, you haven't, he said, taking her hand and stroking it. Before I became a middle-aged bore, I used to pretend that I was John of Gaunt.
Soothed and smoothed by good food and wine, Millie walked slowly towards the hotel car park while Forbes went to the gents. The sunlight was blinding, and she shaded her eyes while she looked round at the other cars. There was no black Studebaker among them, but she no longer expected that there would be. The game had crumbled because the need for it had crumbled. Looking back across the car park for Forbes, she put her hand on the car door and was startled when it flew open, almost knocking her off her feet. Before she could utter a word, someone had grabbed her elbow and dragged her inside. The door slammed, the engine roared, and they were away, sending up a vicious spray of gravel behind them.
You didn't think I'd let you down, did you, Bag?
Asked the man with the pockmarked face. Driving Forbes' car swiftly and competently through the traffic, he gave Millie a loving grin.
I phoned Harry while you were eating. He's waiting for you down at Maisie's place. We'll be there about 4, I told him.
Millie made an inarticulate sound, grabbed the steering wheel and grazed the side of a bus.
You're all het up, the man said soothingly. And no wonder with you and Harry being apart so long. How long did you say you'd been married to him?
They came to a halt at the traffic lights. Taking a deep breath, Millie rolled the window down and fixed the man in the next car with a desperate eye.
Please help me,
she said in a small, deadly voice.
I'm being kidnapped.
The car was a Mercedes, and the blue-chinned driver flicked her a bored glance.
You don't say, he said,
and then turned off left towards Hampton Court.